big business in the Philippines, throughout the Pacific, Tonga, Fiji, about $6 million a year in the Philippines, 1,000 tons per year. Once these Taiwanese fishing vessels come in, they take every single sea cucumber, these are sea cucumbers, by the way, off the reef that they can find. Or they ask the local fishermen to collect them for them. And they offer them a nickel apiece. And then the next week, they come back and say, oh, we'll give you a dime apiece. So everybody tries a little bit harder to get the remaining increasingly rare ones that are left. So this is Besh Damer. This is these are holothuroid sea common name of sea cucumbers, removed again by the thousands from the reef. You have to open them up and take their squishy, gooey insides out and throw them away, that their body wall then is dried in the sun, boiled and dried in the sun, and boiled, ends up dried. Each of these big glass jars is filled with dried sea cucumbers, and they range, once they're dried, on the market, particularly in Hong Kong and China. Hong Kong has the high-end market, but throughout China, for $15 to up to $1,700 a kilogram. And then here it is in your meal. Probably not my meal.
Does anybody taste like anything at all? Does it taste the flavor of the sauce?
It's like jellyfish, right? It's just the fact that you ate it. And so there's that kind of market for it. It's another luxury food, pretty much. But they're removing the ecological services from the reef that these sea cucumbers do. They're the vacuum cleaners. They slurp up sand and with it's got mud or sediment attached to it, and digest the bacteria, digest the organics, and then poop back things down in the back. So you see these little clean poop trails behind the sea cucumber, you know, if they're doing their job. Mother of pearl. Especially in the 1800s, early 1900s, this was really, really big business. James Cook was sent out to find the Northwest Passage and other useful things that he could find on his travel. And mother of pearl was one of those things. Here is the shell. You can use abalone or the trocha shell. And they punch out buttons. Look down. I don't have any buttons today, but I have plenty of blouses and shirts in my closet that have mother of pearl buttons on them. Check it out. So those have been gleaned by usually women, sometimes kids, out on the reef, removing the, here's what it looks like in life, removing some of these, they're removing their ecological services, taking them in, pulling out the meat off of the meat to consume, and then popping out the buttons. About 5,500 tons per year has been estimated, and the shells go for about $20 a kilo. Okay, the marine aquarium trade is another big use of reef resources. This is all in addition to the general fisheries, mind you, of the marine harvest. So marine aquarium trade, estimated to be about $2 million a year in Hawaii. Have you heard all of the controversy right now in our legislature and among scientists about, is this a sustainable harvest? There are some really good studies done in the 80s and 90s to show that it is a sustainable harvest because the numbers are pretty low. And the fish that are targeted, and mainly it's yellowtang, come back rapidly. There are other people who think this is a horrible thing, because they come here to dive and snorkel and they want to see the fish. The scientists come back and say, you are seeing the fish. It's the same amount of fish you've seen it there. They weren't being removed for the marine aquarium trade. So it brings in about $2 million a year to Hawaii and sometimes up to $20,000 a fish. $20,000 a fish. Do you know what the, did I tell you guys this? Do you know what the number one fishery is in Kaneohe Bay? It's a feather duster worm that's collected for the aquarium trade. And the fishermen get about a buck a piece and they sell them to the shops. And the shops sell them for $20-$25 a piece for your home aquarium. Anyway, some fish, because collectors are collectors, right? They want this fish, this, the rarer, the better. If your buddy doesn't have it, it's cooler if you've got it in your tank. So some fish species, deep water particularly, gone for $20,000 a fish. There's some of them. I've been to some operations in, not Christmas Island, Rarotonga. And there are very well maintained, very well managed aquarium collectors in these areas. Sometimes they make mistakes as well. But it's estimated globally that about 30 million fish are removed from the reef each year. And nearly all of those die within a year of capture. Because they just, most of us don't really know how to take care of fish in a home aquarium. And many fish, the most beautiful ones are coralivores. That means they only eat coral. So you have to have enough coral of the right species for that particular fish to eat in your tank, and that's challenging. But here's the target, because it is so adorable, right? The yellow little tank. Okay, another maybe surprising extracted use of reefs is algae. Particularly, example I'll tell you about is Euchuma and Capophycus. 65,000 metric tons are grown in the Philippines. It's worth tens of millions of dollars. You'll hear more about it later on. Here's some Euchuma being farmed, and it's farmed in Zanzibar, the Philippines, Indonesia, and there's been a great deal of research in Hawaii on farming of Euchuma. I'll tell you what happened later. But it's big business in many places in the Pacific. Again, where they have artisanal fisheries. Okay. So here's an area again. Coral reefs represent about 0.09% of the entire area of this planet. The one that we need a second one of. But the diversity of species, types of animals that they hold is remarkable. So on land and fresh water, the total number of phyla is about 19, whereas on coral reefs, we already know 31 phyla. These are upper levels of taxonomy. So the diversity is on coral reefs is many legislators, rulemakers, decision makers want a number. What's the economic value of a reef? If I'm a hotel owner in Waikiki and my beach is disappearing, I want to restore my beach, right? Because my visitors want a beach in front of the hotel. How do I do that? Well, I buy sand from somewhere and I hire an engineer and a contractor and they bring in sand. And then what happens? The sand, does it stay in one place when you leave it on the beach? So there's environmental impact to beach replenishment. How much impact? How much coral are we predicting to lose? Is some coral death okay? And what's the value of the coral out there in front of your hotel, in front of the Sheraton? So people have tried to wrap their heads around, okay, what is the value of a reef? What's the value of a reef? A few years ago, we had a huge Navy vessel. I don't know, guys were asleep at the switch. This ship had just been outfitted with like $30 billion worth of new navigational equipment. Had every state-of-the-art technology on board. They were bringing it into Pearl Harbor, and what did they do? They ran. This is the Port Royal. How did this possibly happen? They ran aground, and then it went from bad to worse. When they brought in tugs, they threw chains down to grab the ship. The chains moved back and forth over the top of the reef, scraped, further scraping off corals in the area as they tried to stabilize the situation. It was just a mess. Well, more recently, we had the fishing boat come ashore right off of Waikiki, right? Everybody saw it. It was there for how many weeks before they got that fishing boat off? And what was it doing the entire time? Rocking back and forth, destroying coral. Is the owner responsible? Yes. Should they be fined? Yes. How much? What's a report? These questions are raised around not just Hawaii, but around the world, wherever there are reefs. And so people have struggled to try to estimate. So here's some numbers for you, for us. This is all from a UN environmental program published in 2009. It was a huge endeavor to come up with this little number. So a hectare, which is about 2.5 acres of reef, provides in annual services about $130,000 US dollars on average, but in some areas can be as much as $1.2 million per hectare. So these are human services. What are those human services? Just talked about some. Food, raw materials, if you want to build your house out of coral, some places. Ornamental resources, we just talked about buttons. So that's about $1,000 a hectare. But climate regulation, moderation of extreme events, waste treatment of water purification averages about $26,000 per hectare. Cultural services, so was it worth to us to have a reef out there to snorkel on or over? That's even higher, $88,000 a hectare. The maintenance of genetic diversity on this planet. I don't know how they put a number to this, but the number the UN came up with is about $13,000. But so taken together, the coral reef services have an average annual value of $172 billion worldwide. So some numbers to wrap your head around anyway. It's not inconsequential, certainly. Herman Cesar worked here for the White Coral Reef Initiative, gosh, been that long ago, 15 years ago, and came up with a value of $29.8 billion per year. Again, this is globally, of the economic value of reefs. And again, broken down into tourism, recreation, coastal protection. That's also an equivalent to providing surf breaks, right? Fisheries and biodiversity. Palau reef tourism, here's a good number, $13 million per year is what tourism is worth in Palau. And there are only 20,000 people who live there. On the Great Barrier Reef, there are 2 million visitor days per year. That was in 2013, 5 years ago. So it's worth that industry is worth $5 to $6 billion per year. Anybody want to go to the Great Barrier Reef? In Bonaire in the Caribbean, scuba-related tourism is estimated to be worth about $21 million a year. That's half of their GNP, gross national product. I think it's important to them to keep their reefs healthy. And they do. Every reef in Bonaire is protected. The entire coral reef around Bonaire is protected. And in Hawaii, this is Herman Cesar in Pukuri, a year later, estimated that Hawaii's reefs are worth about $360 million per year, or $10 billion in total. Oh, here are these ship groundings that lawyers have come up with. Okay, are my client's actions, if we admit it, might have damaged this many square meters of reef? In Florida, the fine is, you're going to get nailed for $1,000 per meter square. In Egypt, it was almost twice that, $1,700 per square meter. But, you know, how long does it take to regrow a 500-year-old coral? Okay, and good to keep in mind that values are more than monetary, of course. So, in many island nations particularly, the social structure revolves around fishing. So you have to have a healthy reef to keep that going. We noted that we provide shoreline protection so the waves aren't breaking right on the sand in Waikiki. Also for pharmaceuticals, and this has been big business. A lot of amazing chemicals have been found on from reef organisms. Prostaglandins that are used to treat cardiovascular disease and asthma in Borgonians. Anti-tumor chemicals in red algae. This deep leukemia drug by vitamin B and tunicates. And this pain management drug, Creedol from home snails. There's a researcher here, J.P. Morgan, who's been working in cone snail venom. Here's the cone snail, gorgeous thing. So they're doing all this work. Creedol, by the way, is thought to be, is known to be 100 to 1,000 times more effective at pain killing, a particular pain, than morphine, but it's not addictive. Yay. But there are hundreds of these conotoxins, hundreds of species, different species of bone snails produce everything from nervous system disorders, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, depression, quitting smoking, and perhaps schizophrenia. But JP has been worried that it's getting harder and harder to find these guys on the reef because they've been collected by people doing this kind of research. So he has learned how to milk the toxins out of cone snails. How about that? Just like they milk rattlesnake venom, you know, to do research on rattlesnakes. They do the same thing with cone snails. They get them to strike a fish, and then when they've struck, they, I don't know how they do it. Be better careful. Okay, so coral reefs are some of the most productive ecosystems on Earth, and yet they're the most vulnerable to overharvest. We'll hear more about that from Dr. Friedlander. They have the greatest influence on the face of the Earth. You can see them from space, and they're most vulnerable to human activities. These huge structures, though, are created by this teeny, thin layer of living tissue. All of the skeleton, as Dr. Berkman told us, is covered by a thin veneer of living tissue. Has some of the oldest and longest existing genera of any on the Earth. But the canaries and the coal mines, you've lost 50% of reefs. 50% of reefs in your lifetime. 50% of the reefs in the world have died in my lifetime, your lifetime. And they have a huge effect on climate Earth and on the most sensitive climate change. Okay, here's some of the things just to recap. You can read this and you're going to go, oh, you make reefs. You know why we love reefs. Have a good weekend. See you guys on Monday.